Hello, this is part 3 of my series on coding an AI to play the Teamfight Tactics video game. This video is a brief overview of the TypeScript language, which will provide the foundation needed to understand the rest of the series. This is a basic course and is beginner friendly. Most importantly, we're going to learn by writing real code related to the TFT game, not some boring academic examples. If you haven't watched the previous video in the series, you may want to watch that first to understand the rules of the TFT game. If you have any interest in a career in coding, I suggest JavaScript as a starting point. There are pros and cons to every programming language, and JavaScript isn't necessarily perfect, but it is the most widely used language. This makes it a safe bet during a job search as a new coder. JavaScript's initial popularity came from its use in building websites, but you can also code traditional desktop applications and mobile apps with it as well. Most programming languages have very similar features, even though they use a different syntax. Once you've learned the fundamental concepts in one language, you can easily switch to a similar language. Although I'm using TypeScript for my project, it's simply an extension on top of JavaScript. It adds new features to the language while still being 100% backwards compatible. For simple apps, I think JavaScript is good, but I prefer TypeScript when building large or complex apps. Switching between JavaScript and TypeScript is really easy, so I suggest trying them both to see which one you prefer. You can code JavaScript directly in Notepad, but it's much easier with proper tools. I use VS Code, which you can download for free. Let's write some code to help us simulate a TFT game. A program is basically a set of step-by-step instructions telling the computer what to do, like a cooking recipe. Apps can contain hundreds or thousands of lines of code, so we need a way to keep it all organized. Functions help us to do that. They are the most basic building block. The root of a program should be a bunch of small functions, each designed to perform one simple task. Then, more and more complicated tasks can be solved by combining these smaller functions together. For example, these functions build upon each other. The great thing is that functions are self-contained, so they can each be coded by a different person, and you can execute a function without understanding how the code inside it actually works. For example, the shuffle cards feature will require a random number generator, which is actually surprisingly difficult to code. Computers can't do random, so it must be simulated with tricky math formulas or by gathering data from a random source in nature. Luckily, this problem has already been solved many times already by our coding ancestors, so I can just pick a solution I like rather than writing it myself. JavaScript does have a built-in math.random function, but I'm going to use the one from the Lodash library instead, because it's more powerful, has great documentation, and also provides a bunch of other utility functions that I'll be using. You can search for open source libraries like Lodash on the npm.js website. It might feel wrong to use another person's code, but they've donated it, so it's not stealing. As you progress in your career, you'll have the chance to give back to the community. When we help each other, everyone wins. Open source libraries are usually designed to solve generic problems. Anything specific to your application will still have to be coded by hand. Here's my basic implementation. The import statement allows me to reference the entire Lodash library API by using the underscore symbol as a prefix. I'm using its clone and shuffle methods. My shuffle cards function takes a list of cards as input and returns a separate randomized list as output. The terms cards and result are called variables. A variable stores a value you want to remember in computer memory to be used later on. You can give it any name you want. It's important to pick names carefully so that other people will understand your code when reading it. The let keyword defines a new variable. The equals symbol assigns a value to the variable. The parentheses are for specifying the input values when executing a function. Since functions are self-contained, only the code between the two curly braces can see the cards and result variables. This is important because it allows us to test each function independently to ensure it's working without fear of side effects from other parts of our program. You can change the value inside a variable at any time. I could have shuffled the cards variable without creating an extra result variable. However, I created a new variable to avoid confusion. It's harder to analyze code when the same variable has different values at different times. You might think it's strange that I cloned the original list of cards. For performance reasons, programming languages copy values for small variables, like numbers, but share values for complex variables, like lists or objects. When a variable is shared, it's no longer contained inside a single function, meaning it can be modified by multiple sections of code. This can cause confusion and bugs. If runtime speed isn't important, I usually clone lists or objects before I modify them to avoid this issue. It's important to recognize that there isn't only one correct way to code something. Every programmer has a different opinion. In the end, the only thing that really matters is if the users of your app are happy with it. They won't ever see how ugly the code is underneath. There are endless debates about proper coding techniques. Once you become an expert, you should think about the pros and cons of different coding styles. But for now, just focus on what works for you. Don't be afraid to experiment. You won't break anything. If you focus too much on writing perfect code the first time, you might get roadblocks before you even get started. Now that we've written our shuffle cards function, we need to execute it. To do that, we need to pass a value to the cards parameter as an input variable. The question is, what value should we pass? It's not immediately obvious. Converting from JavaScript to TypeScript solves this problem. Now it's obvious that our function expects an array of unit types. A class is a group of related variables and functions. An array is a list of values. I can reference the first card using cards bracket 0, and the second card using cards bracket 1. Note that with arrays, the first item starts at 0, which feels a bit unnatural to a human. I called it a unit type instead of a card to match how the TFT game works. It's only considered a card while it's still in your hand. Once you deploy it to the battlefield, it becomes a unit. Units have additional attributes that unit types don't have, like held items. I'm not ready to code those yet, so I used two forward slashes to make a comment, which is a note to myself for later. I'm using the unit type class just to store the base values that units of the same type will share in common. The public keyword allows the name and gold cost variables to be accessed by other code outside the class. A constructor is a special function used for setting the initial values of the internal variables of the class. Note that a class itself is not a variable, it's just a definition. The new keyword takes the class definition and executes its constructor function to create and initialize the variable. In this case, Heimerdinger and Karma are each object variables with the same class type, but they each have their own internal name and gold cost variables. TypeScript helps us to document our code by specifying what data type belongs to each variable. It will also give you warnings if you're putting an incorrect value into a variable. To illustrate the concept of data types, let's look at an example. What does the word tuna mean to you? If you speak English, it's a type of fish. If you speak Spanish, it's a cactus fruit. Either way, the word tuna is spelled and pronounced exactly the same. If you were talking to a bilingual person and you only said the word tuna, they wouldn't understand you until you told them which language you were speaking. This same problem exists for computers. For example, all values are stored in the computer as binary, or ones and zeros. I've put an example on the screen. What do you think that value represents to the computer? Well, it depends. If it's interpreted as an integer, it represents 122. If it's interpreted as text, it represents the lowercase letter z. If it's interpreted as a color, it's dark red. As a decimal, it's 1.7 with 42 zeros. A variable's data type tells the computer how to interpret its value. Incorrect data types can cause bugs in a program. Here's an example. Let bug equal quote 1 plus 1. The quotes around the first value interpret it as text instead of a number. So the result here is the text 11 instead of the number 2, because the addition operator on text simply appends the words together. It honestly doesn't make any sense to add text and a number together. However, that's what the JavaScript creators chose. By switching to TypeScript, you get warnings for these types of mistakes. It can be annoying to specify the data type of each variable, so I still use JavaScript for quick coding, but I switch to TypeScript when I'm writing large or complex apps. I think the extra typing saves me more time in the long run because it makes my code easier to understand and helps me avoid bugs. The most common data types in JavaScript are Boolean, which is true and false, numbers, strings, or text, arrays, which are a list of items, and objects, which are a collection of related variables. You can also create your own data types by creating class definitions. The bulk of the shuffle function we wrote earlier actually borrowed code from an open source library. Let's learn how to write our own logic. First, let me remind you of one of the concepts in the TFT game. After each battle, TFT grants gold as income to the player based on a few criteria. Before I show you how I chose to code this, take a second to think about how you would do it. Maybe pause the video for a second to give yourself time to think. It might be helpful to open a text editor so you can try typing up your code as well. I've coded it like this. I used if statements to make decisions based on the value of my input variables. The condition in parentheses must evaluate to true in order for the code underneath the if to execute. Otherwise, it is skipped. The double ampersand operator means and. It allows you to specify two conditions that both have to be true. This chart shows the other logical operators. The plus plus operator is a shorthand to increase the variable's value by one. You could also write it as income equals income plus one. The plus equals operator is a similar shorthand, except it also lets you specify the amount of the increase. The forward slash operator is used for performing mathematical division. The math.floor function removes any decimal value from the remainder of that division. The math.min function will return the smaller of the two input values. The other if statements use comparison operators. For example, the triple equals symbol compares if two values are equal. Here's a chart of the other comparison operators. The else and else if commands can be chained to the bottom of an if statement. You can think of an else like a fork in the road. You can only choose one path. The first condition that evaluates to true will execute. All others will be skipped. I'll let you read through the rest of the code without any explanation to see if you can understand it on your own. Pause the video if you need more time. To execute this code, we can use the Node.js platform. This allows JavaScript to execute as a standalone app, instead of in the web browser. Node.js also gives us access to operating system APIs that are not available in a browser due to security concerns. Let's make sure we coded it correctly by testing against an example from inside the game. It says we should get 9 gold, which would put our total at 28. That's the same as the game, so it looks like it's working correctly. Note, in the real world, it's best to test multiple scenarios to be safe. For example, we have several if-else conditions in our function. Ideally, we should do a separate test for each possible path, because we've only tested one of them. One key benefit to JavaScript is that it's known as a functional language. This means that you can actually put a function into a variable and pass it as a parameter to another function. This allows really complex logic by combining very simple functions. Pause the screen and see if you can understand what this code is doing. Let's look at another example. Filter is a general purpose function that generates a new array containing only the values from the original array which match a specific criteria. It does not modify the original array. It loops through the original array and executes a function you supply against each value to see if that function returns true. This keyword is used to reference the internal variables and functions of the class. The equals greater than operator is called a lambda, and it's essentially a shorthand for declaring a one-time used function without giving it a name. The variable x represents the current element of the array that's being filtered. You can choose any variable name you want. Length is a property on arrays that returns the count of elements it contains. Functional languages, like JavaScript, have lots of useful functions like filter. You can do a lot of complex logic with simple code if you learn this style of functional coding. The shuffle cards function we wrote earlier requires an array of cards as input. This array is like our deck. The deck in TFT has a lot of copies of the same card, but the number of copies is dependent on the gold cost of the unit. In addition, the deck changes as players draft and discard from it. Let's code a function to generate this deck of cards. Before I show you how I coded it, take some time to think about how you would do it. Pause the video for a minute if you need to. The max cards per gold cost variable is a dictionary. It's a collection of values like an array, but it can be indexed by any value, not just consecutive numbers. I chose it because TFT doesn't have a zero gold cost unit, but an array would have been fine as well. Dictionaries and arrays are optimized for speed. As long as you retrieve a value using its index, they're really fast. If you read the entire collection by retrieving each item one at a time, it can be very slow, depending on the number of items in the list. The static keyword on a variable means that it is shared by all instances of the class. This saves memory in situations where every object of that type will use the exact same value for that variable. The for command creates a loop. These are useful when you want to perform the same operation on a collection of variables, like a dictionary or an array. In this case, I'm looping over each unit type in the array to see how many copies of the card should be in the deck. Map creates a new array by reformatting the values from an existing array. The new values are generated by executing the function you supply against each value of the original array. It does this without modifying the original array. I'm using this to generate a new array containing the count of matching units for each army of the player array. I pass this array to the _.sum function to get the total number of those units already drafted onto any of the player's teams. I do some basic math to calculate the number of that card remaining in the deck, then I use the _.fill function to add them to the array. That covers the basics of JavaScript and TypeScript. If you have any coding questions, ask them in the comments below. I'll cover more advanced topics in a future video. Thanks for watching. Hit the subscribe button for more tutorials and for progress updates on the projects I'm coding.